Grace and peace to you from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We want to say a special welcome to all who are joining us by Facebook, as well as on the radio on the Bear 97.9. Allow me to share with you that you can find our order of worship at centenarychurch.com. Now let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Thank you. from Psalm 118. Please join with me responsibly, and our worship program can be found at centenarychurch.com, and you can follow along with our readings as well as our music this morning. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His steadfast love endures forever.
Let Israel say, His steadfast love endures forever.
The Lord is my strength and my power. The Lord has become my salvation.
There are joyous songs of victory in the tents of the righteous.
The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted.
The right hand of the Lord does valiantly.
I shall not die, but I shall live and recount the deeds of the Lord.
The Lord has chastened me sorely, but has not given me over to death.
Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord.
This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through.
I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation.
The stone which the builders rejected has become my cornerstone.
This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes.
This is the day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Thank you.
Living God, rejoicing in this day of resurrection, we have come to celebrate the strength of your love, a love that triumphs even over death. As we exult in the miracle of your incarnate love, we thank you for the opportunity to encounter the risen Christ here in our midst. Amen.
Oh, this is one.
this time I'd like to invite the children to come forward to your screens at this time or to the radios and come join us for this children's moment.
So that we cannot help but respond
verses 34 through 43, and I invite you to read with me God's word from Acts. Then Peter began to speak to them. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right and acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, who ate and drank with him and after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and of the dead. All the prophets testify about him that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Our epistle lesson comes from Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. So, if you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things that are above, not on things that are on earth, for you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. This is the word of God for us, the people of God.
Fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid. I know you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has been raised from the dead, and indeed is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him. This is my message for you." So they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came to him, took hold of his feet and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Elementary school was for me, like a great many folks, a time of innocence, a time of joy. I remember the years at Key Mill Elementary School as being a safe place, a comfortable time. Sure, there were a few of the kids that teased me now and again, and there were times that I thought that the world was going to end, but generally it was a good time. Populated with people that I had known for almost my entire life, the friends that I had seen all through the years and had grown up with, the teachers that surrounded my life that I would see in the grocery store or at church, Mrs. Sproul, Mrs. Hughes, Mr. Thomas. And there were activities that I enjoyed, the math sheets, the running in the playground, the film strips for those of us of a particular age, and the smell of mimeograph ink on the paper. Generally, it was a time of great joy. When we finished elementary school, we went up the hill to Washington Irving Junior High School. And things changed. Suddenly, there were other kids there, kids that I did not know, kids that had gone to some strange elementary school. There were lockers with combinations that had to be remembered. We switched classes, walking to and from down these big halls with all of these strange people. And we ate lunch any place we wanted to with anybody that would let us. I remember one afternoon feeling a little bit nostalgic and deciding that I would go back to Key Mill to see that space as it had been. And when I walked in the door, the hallways suddenly seemed more narrow than I had ever remembered them being. And it felt as if the ceiling was lower. The kids were smaller. It just didn't fit anymore. One of my friends tells the story of going back to his high school reunion and having a similar kind of experience and the tension that he felt in that moment. He says that there was warmth, there was joy, it was good to see people he remembered, but there was also anxiety. He said he was so very aware of the person that he had been in those days and how very much he wasn't that person any longer. What is not what was, and what was is not the same any longer, and it just doesn't fit together. I began to think about that kind of tension when I came to this year's version of the resurrection story. You see, all four of the Gospels tell the story of Easter Sunday, but they tell it in a slightly different way. Sure, they all of them have the stone being rolled away. They all of them have the empty tomb. And they all of them have that central proclamation that Christ is risen. But they include some minor details. Mark has the women leaving the tomb being afraid and dismayed and telling no one. Luke includes a word from the angel filled with all the meaning of this day. When the angel looks at the women and says to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead?" John includes the story of Mary Magdalene, seeing the risen Jesus for the first time when she hears her name. In the words of that iconic hymn, "The voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses." Matthew's version, the one appointed for this year, has its own version. In the Gospel of Matthew, the angel appears to the women, sitting on the stone, and says to them, "I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. And tell his disciples he has been raised from the dead. Indeed, he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him." And then, as if to make sure we didn't miss this little detail, and Jesus appears to the women and says, "Then tell my brothers to go to Galilee." I found myself thinking about what that would have meant, to go back to Galilee. What these heroes of our faith thought when they heard that word, what would they have? Galilee was the place where they had been. It was in Galilee that they fished. It was in Galilee where they collected taxes. It was in Galilee where they were known by everyone. It was in Galilee where they first heard the voice of Jesus calling to them. It was in Galilee that they saw the miracles. It was in Galilee that they declared their allegiance. Was from Galilee that they set out towards Jerusalem. Now they were called to go back. What would it mean for life of this tomb that is empty? Now life has come to take hold of them, and what would it mean? Because you see, at the core of our message is not just that we have, and we are the agents of resurrection in the world. Brian Blunt describes resurrection as the weapon that God uses in the struggle of life against death. He writes, "In Jesus' resurrection, God has invaded this world occupied by death and fired the first gate and put death down forever. In the meantime, the church is here. We are here. We are on a mission, an invasion mission, to strike life into this death-occupied, death-obsessed, death-wearied world." The disciples' job said that there was more to this life. It was their job to go back and to bring the truth that they knew about Jesus Christ. Been thinking a lot about going back. You see, someday we are going to come back. We're going to come back into this space. We are going to return to worshiping together. Someday children will be going back to school. Someday we will be going back to work. We will be returning to restaurants and to all of the activity that we have known. Question is, what will we bring? How will we, as the witnesses of resurrection, strike life into that new place? Maybe we will bring a renewed sense of the gift of fellowship when we come back together. Maybe we will bring a renewed sense of what is truly important in life. I mean, after all, who even remembers what the headlines were at the beginning of March? Who remembers the things that we thought were so desperately important? Maybe this can be a time for us to remind ourselves of the fundamental first things in life. Family. Love, community. Maybe we'll remember who the real heroes in our world are. The teachers, the nurses, the doctors. Maybe we can let go of our love of celebrity. Remind ourselves of the possibility. And remember always that we are in this together. We who mark this day live in that tension between the world as it used to be and the world as it can be. And we are the ones who bring witness to life in this death-weary, death-obsessed world. Because we know that the tomb is empty. We know that Christ is risen. We know that there is life. Easter Sunday is an invitation to dream, to take hold of what can be, and to be the embodiment of that dream, even when it means that we go back together. Amen. Our hymn is Crown Him with Many Crowns.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now as we turn to our time of offering, I will share with you that there is a link in our Facebook feed if you would like to give online or at centenarychurch.com. Now we offer ourselves to God and our gifts for the ministry of Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
One joy that I'd like to share this morning, and several of you have mentioned it on our Facebook page, and that's just a thankfulness that we can still come together as a congregation on this Easter Sunday. So for that, thanks be to God. We do have several prayer concerns that have been shared this morning, and feel free to email those into the office to Pastor Tom or myself, and we'll make sure that those prayer concerns that you have are shared. Billy Greener, a family member of Tom's, has a secondary infection from COVID-19. He is at home, but do please keep Billy Greener in your prayers. Also, prayers for Bishop Sam Weenie. Sam Weenie is one word. This is the bishop from Ghana that Tom is familiar with, Pastor Tom. Met his mother passed away this week. We lift him up, and unfortunately, because of what we are dealing with right now, Bishop Sam Weenie would not be able to have a funeral for his mother at this time. So we do lift that family up as they struggle through this. Other prayer concerns and requests this morning from Mary Hudson. She says that her sister in Seattle has COVID-19 and was admitted into the hospital this week. We will lift Mary's sister up. Another prayer request from Tabitha Daniels to pray for all of our healthcare workers and other essential workers during this trying time. I would like us to pray for everyone that is suffering from this virus, and I would like the Lord to bless everyone and everything and give everyone hope. And I think we all share in that sentiment this morning. Finally, we have a prayer from the Times family. We need prayers for all of those who have lost loved ones during this time of no hugs. Not able to have a funeral, family connections, not being able to be made with out-of-towners, and postponing for what right now seems like forever until they can have a proper funeral. So we do lift them this morning. For the prayers that are on our hearts this morning, God, we ask that you lift those off of us as well and ease our burdens. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Lord of mystery and Lord of marvels, you have walked with us on this Lenten journey, this strange Lenten journey that we've been on. And you've seen how we've responded to those whom Jesus encountered along the path, because we have heard their stories. We've seen their pain. And we've witnessed the love that Jesus offered them and the miracles that have taken place in their lives. And now, as we socially distance, we still come together on this brilliant, beautiful day. In the day where there are beautiful flowers in our sanctuary, where the candles are lit, where music is sung and played, and where spirits are filled and lifted in joy. Be in our hearts, Lord. Remind us that the journey to the cross does not end in death, but it becomes a road of joy. It becomes a road of life. Lift our spirits, lift our hearts to sing your praises and gratitude for everything that you do and have done for us. Let the light of Jesus shine on us, in us, and through us as we witness your eternal presence and your love for us. We ask this prayer in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray while saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever." The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is "The Day of Resurrection."
And now may the power of God, which raised Jesus Christ from the dead, strengthen you in hope, enrich you in love, and fill you with all joy of life, both now and forevermore.